Welcome to Duck Church. My name is Chris. I'm the pastor here. I'm so glad that you've joined us as we worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ today. Today we're going to be looking at Psalm 139 verses 7 through 12 specifically, and the message is, O love that wilt not let me go. I am so glad you're here today. And in the way of announcements, I just wanted to mention that the United Methodist Women had their jumble sale this past week. There were lots of people that it took to put that together, to organize it and make it all work. And so thank you for everyone who worked behind the scenes, in front of the scenes, around the scenes, and helped set up, clean up, and all those things. And I think it was a very successful day. This is the United Methodist Women's one time a year fundraising, and then that goes to support many mission projects through the year. So thank you for that, and thank you for those who came and supported that as well. Are there any other announcements that need to be lifted up? All right. So in your, I think on the aisles, there are these little blue pads, and it's a place to register your attendance. So if you would take a moment and do that. And while you're doing that, let me just say that in the next few weeks, we're going to transition from these pew pads to something called a connection card. And it will be in your bulletin. That will be the way that we'll register our attendance. And then on the back side of that will be a way that we can sign up for different opportunities and different places to serve in the life of the church, find out information about things we want to know about. And so that'll be coming in the next few weeks. I know nobody really likes change, but this will be a really good one, I'm sure. So just be patient with us as we move towards that. I just want to make mention that Jim and Claudette Braswell are here. And Claudette, just if you wouldn't mind just raising your hand, Claudette, back here. They're visiting with us. And Claudette is an ordained deacon in the United Methodist Church. And they're getting ready to celebrate their 60th wedding anniversary. And I just thought we might celebrate with them. Congratulations. And now if you'll join me in the call to worship, and let's just stand and read together what you find in your bulletin. Weaver of life, framer of the ages, we marvel at your artistry and the trust you place in us. From our first cries to our final breaths, we are your own. Bind us now to each other in ways beyond our choosing, that your purpose might find fulfillment in our common life and service. And as we're standing, let's turn to our hymnals, to number 453, as we sing together, More Love to Thee, O Christ.
be seated.
Trusting in the power of God, not only to fashion the world, but to mend and refashion our hearts. Let us say how it is with us as we pray together the prayer of confession you find printed in your bulletin. Holy God, like children long indulged, we are quick to presume your pardon, your sanction of the way we live. We turn away from neighbors in need, sharing fragments that remain only after our cravings have been met. Merciful Father, you created us for better use. Remake us now. Where we are distorted, recenter and reshape us. Bring us low and raise us up. Then fire our hearts until we shine with your glory and find our place in your purpose. Hear this declaration of forgiveness. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. Brothers and sisters, in the name of Christ, I declare that your story is known, your sin is forgiven, your life is made new. Let us live as those reborn. And as those that have been forgiven, let us pray together the prayer of our Lord. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All that we are points back to our Creator. All that we have is gift and trust. God will finish what He has begun. We have the privilege of taking part. With grateful hearts, let us bring our tithes and our offerings to God from whom they've come. creation, your claim on us is total, your desire for us complete. We cannot follow Christ from a comfortable distance. Yet we ask that you would receive us this day and use what we bring. Keep sending your Spirit into our hearts until we yield all that we love and all that we fear to your holy purpose. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And while we're standing, let's take this opportunity to share the peace of Christ with one another. I love the sounds of a church that loves one another. That's a beautiful, beautiful sound. As forgiven and reconciled people now, let us join together in the Apostles' Creed that you find written in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Standing, let's join together and find hymn number 480 in our hymnals as we're going to sing, O Love That Wilt Not Let Me Go.
may be seated.
In your bulletin, there is a little outline that has the scripture from Psalm 139 today, and we're going to get to that as we go through the message, but there's also a little fill-in-the-blank there that may be helpful for you as well. So today we're beginning a new series that explores the story behind some of our best-loved hymns. And our first story takes place in Scotland in the mid to late 1800s. The story is about George Matheson, who at the age of 20 had what appeared to be a brilliant future ahead of him. He was an outstanding theology student preparing for what would certainly be a distinguished career in academia. He was also engaged to the woman of his dreams. Everything was just right. Except he was beginning to lose his sight. Slowly, little by little, day by day, his world became increasingly dark. How can one become a scholar with no ability to read? Braille was still in its infancy, and the options were very limited. His fiancée decided that she couldn't bear going through life with a blind husband, so she broke off the engagement, and George Matheson's world became undone. However, he didn't let this setback hold him back. He decided instead to become a pastor and began serving a small church. His sister became his devoted assistant. She studied Greek, Hebrew, and Latin to help him with his sermon preparation and his writing. She accompanied him throughout the day, assisting him with all of his pastoral responsibilities. Over the years, George Matheson became quite successful in the ministry. He pastored a large church, and he wrote several books of theology, poetry, and sacred music. And then one day, his sister told him that she had fallen in love and that she planned to marry, and she would soon be leaving to begin a new life and a new family with her husband. And George realized that he would be all alone. For 20 years, his sister had been his connection to the seeing world. She had read to him, she completed his research, she had been his scribe and his partner in ministry, and now he was all alone again. On the night before her wedding, he said, "Something happened to me which was known only to myself and which caused me the most severe mental suffering." Those close to him understood that he was reminded of the time so many years before, as he was preparing to get married and the love of his life let him go. And now he was losing his closest friend and confidant, his sister. And so that night, June 6th, 1882, as George Matheson thought about the love he had lost years before, and as he thought about the lonely days that lie ahead, he wrote these words, "O love, thou wilt not let me go. I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life I owe, that in thine ocean's depths its flow may richer, fuller be." There are some here today who understand on a deep and personal level the story behind this hymn and what George Matheson felt, because you too have felt at times abandoned and alone. No doubt we've all felt that way. Today I want to talk to you about a love that will not let you go. The love that you can count on to be present in your life no matter what comes your way. We'll look at one of the Psalms written by King David. Now, King David, as you know, wrote some of the most beautiful and memorable poetry, not only in all of Scripture, but in all of literature. His most famous, of course, would be the Shepherd's Psalm, Psalm 23. A portion of it says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. He also wrote in Psalm 16, verse 6, the boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. Now, he wrote both of these psalms relatively early in his life, and if you know anything about King David's history, you know that his life wasn't always about slaying giants and writing scripture and sitting beside still waters. He knew something of failure and heartache and disappointment and betrayal and regret. His son Amnon brutally assaulted his own sister. David's other son, Absalom, killed Amnon in revenge. And then one of David's military leaders killed Absalom. And when the dust had settled, his two sons were dead, his daughter was left traumatized, and his family was torn apart. David understood heartache. At another point in his life, David himself committed murder and adultery, and his infant child died. And so you wonder if David, who had written so eloquently about God's loving kindness in his early years, you wonder if he changed his tune a bit in his latter years after he had suffered some losses and life had a chance to beat him up a bit. If so, he wouldn't be the first old man to become bitter about life, would he? Actually, he didn't change his tune at all. Today we're going to look at Psalm 139, which is most likely the last psalm that David wrote. In this psalm, he talks about the love that will not let him go, and he talks about the God who is always near. He talks about the God who knows him inside and out, the God who has always known him, who knit him together in his mother's womb, and who planned all of his days before he ever lived a single one of them. And so today, if you're feeling abandoned and alone, hopeless, helpless, full of fear, I want to remind you of three truths from God's word that you can cling to even in your most difficult hours. The first truth I want you to cling to is that God's light can pierce the darkest darkness. King David wrote in verse 11, if I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light will become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for the darkness is as light to you. Maybe this is the very verse that Matthison was thinking of when he wrote this line. O light that followest all my way, I yield my flickering torch to thee. My heart restores its borrowed ray, that in thy sunshine's blaze its day may brighter, fuller be. You know, there are times when it feels like our lives are just sunny and bright, and there are times when we feel like our torch is flickering. We don't understand why things happen the way they happen. We don't have a clear idea about what to do next. I know of a man who, after a long engagement, married the woman of his dreams. Both of them had already been through some heartbreak, but now they were ready to become a blended family. She quit her job, and they all moved to a new city. And then, before they could barely get started in their new life together, the bottom fell out for him career-wise and money-wise. Afterward, he asked God 1,000 times, why couldn't this have happened 3 months before the wedding instead of 3 months after? We could have changed our plans. Why did it have to happen this way? And later he said to a close friend, and I quote, I never realized how God could sustain us through these dark and difficult days, but he has. I want you to know that during your dark and difficult days, there is a light that will shine in your darkness. It may seem like only a glimmer, like a flickering torch, but it will keep you going and it will lead you into a brighter, fairer fullness of God's brilliant light. God's light can pierce the darkest darkness. The second truth that I want you to cling to from God's word is that God's ear is always within the sound of your voice. King David wrote in verse 7 and 8, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there." He's saying that no matter where I go, high or low, near or far, God is close by. And I want you to know that God is not only close by, he is actually listening. In Psalm 116, David says, "He hath heard my voice and my supplications. He hath inclined his ear unto me." The New Living Translation says, "He bends down to listen." Picture that in your mind. The God of all creation who spoke everything into being with merely a word. The God who is all powerful. The God with whom nothing is impossible. Bends down and listens when we speak to him. There are times, I know, when it feels like God is not near, that God does not hear, because things don't always go the way we want them to or the way that we expect them to. When life gets tough, it feels like it's too far away, that God's too far away to hear anything that we have to say. And this is why Jesus told his disciples in their final moments together, "And surely I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Jesus knew that the road that lay before the disciples would sometimes be rocky, and he wanted them to remember that there is no place that you can go where God isn't. Even in the midst of the worst days of your life, even if your times of in your times of greatest heartache and loss, God is always near and God will always hear. God is always within the sound of your voice. This is the time more than any other that you don't rely on your feelings. We put our faith instead in his promise. We find it in Hebrews 13:5. "Never will I leave you, and never will I forsake you." I studied Greek when I was in seminary. And I looked up that word, never. And do you know what that word means in Greek? It means never. Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you. And this brings me to the third truth that I want you to cling to. God's hand is always within your reach. David wrote in verses 9 and 10, "If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast." I'm speaking from experience when I say to you that you will never feel as alone in life or as afraid as you feel when a storm comes sweeping into your life. There's no word to describe the sense of uncertainty, wondering what might happen next. What should I do next? In these moments, I'll tell you what you can do. You can reach out to God and let him take you by the hand. Let God guide you through the debris left by the storm, and he will do it. Just as you can experience a glimmer of light during your darkest days, you can experience a glimmer of hope and peace and joy even in the midst of your most painful trials. Maybe this is why Matheson wrote, "O joy that seekest me through pain, I cannot close my heart to thee. I trace the rainbow through the rain and feel the promise is not vain, that morn shall tearless be." This time of trial is not how the story ends for you. It's just one tiny chapter in an epic narrative of God's work in your life. And it's important for you to remember that you don't face these days alone. One person said that you will never know that God is all you need until God is all you have. Storms often drive us to that very place of recognition. In these moments, you can say, God, I have no one but you. Jesus, hold my hand. Walk with me through this dark valley. And you can be sure that he will. Psalm 139 is a reminder that God loves you with a love that will never let you go. His light can pierce the darkest darkness. His ear can hear the most desperate prayer. His hand can guide you through the deepest, darkest valley if you will turn to him. We talked about going through times of trial and how so often these seasons seem to come out of nowhere, unexpected and unprovoked. But there's another type of storm that we face, and I'm talking about the storms that we foolishly go looking for, the storms we bring on ourselves through reckless and sinful behavior. These storms are even more difficult to endure because of the voice that keeps ringing in our ears. You don't deserve mercy. You don't deserve a second chance. You deserve this. It's true. We don't deserve mercy. But the very definition of God's grace is undeserved mercy. He forgives us not because we could ever possibly do anything to earn our forgiveness, but because he loved you so much that he sent his son to die on the cross of Calvary alone and abandoned so that our sin might be forgiven once and for all. Matheson closed out his hymn with these words, O cross that liftest up my head, I dare not ask to fly from thee. I lay in dust, life's glory dead, and from the ground there blossoms red, life that shall endless be. In his poetry, he's saying that God can take the most broken situation, the most broken circumstance, the most broken life, and turn it into a creation of beauty. Your broken life can blossom red, even when sin has turned everything into dust. God loves you with a love that will not let you go. Even when you were at your worst, God sent his very best, his only son, to die on the cross so that you might live. And nothing can ever separate us from his love. Romans 8, verses 38 and 39, drill home that truth. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ our Lord. It is a love that will never let you go. And so today, I invite you to call out Jesus' name and take a hold of his hand and let him guide you every step of the way. Amen. Well, I don't know if you are an altar call church or not, but you're getting an altar call this morning. I believe that we can't, thank you. I believe we can't hear God's word and remain the same as we were before we heard it. God's word demands a response from us, something. We can't remain the same. And so as we prepare to stand and sing this hymn, I want to invite you to come. Maybe you've had some dark times in your life, or maybe you're in a dark place now. The storms of life are raging in your life. Maybe it's a health crisis, or maybe it's a relationship that's broken. I don't know what it might be. But I want you to know that God hears you, that God will hold your hand, and that God's light can pierce that darkest darkness that you're experiencing. Or maybe God has seen you through, and right now things are fair sailing, and you just want to thank him for his faithfulness. Whatever it is that brings you here, you can come and kneel or stand here at the altar. You can use the steps. You can make an altar of your heart and bow before him where you stand. But don't miss this opportunity, because these are precious moments that God longs to spend with his children. So would you come as we stand and sing together hymn number 111, How Can We Name a Love? Come back next Sunday. If you're in town, we will continue our series of messages based on favorite hymns, and the scripture that we're going to focus on next Sunday will be Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. I hope you'll be here, and I hope you'll invite a friend to come and worship with you. And now let's receive this blessing. May you leave this place to go out into the world with the knowledge that God will never let you go. Walk in his strength this week. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.